Sector 3 on the Acropolis of Bylazora is the area where Ivan Mikulcic opened a sounding in the 1980s. He discovered a stretch of the Acropolis defensive wall. His trench was eventually backfilled in the 1990s, but when the joint TFAHR and People's Museum of Sveti Nikola excavation team started work at Bylazora in 2008, we were able to relocate the trench without much difficulty. We decided to expand the original sounding in all four directions and dig deeper.
After two seasons, we came to realize that this was not a single stretch of wall, but a casemate wall. That is, a double wall divided into rooms with a fighting platform on top. We followed this wall to the east in the 2008 excavation season and unearthed an inclined paved road or ramp. As we came later to realize, it was part of a propylon, a monumental gateway. In subsequent years, we expanded our excavations around the propylon and adjacent city walls. By the end of the 2011 season, we had a good idea about both the history and composition of the propylon. A full analysis of the propylon is to be found in Volume 1 of the TFAHR Bylazora publication, in an article by Amy Donaldson, Frederick Mej, and Swapomir Shishka.
Before the construction of the propylon, which we tentatively date to the early 4th century BC, this particular stretch of the northern part of the Acropolis was defended by a 1 meter thick defensive wall, of which the western section is part of a casemate wall. Along this stretch of wall, we discovered the bases of two large towers in the 2010 and 2011 seasons. Between the towers, an approximately 4 meter wide road led up to the Acropolis. This road was probably just dirt, with flat sidewalk flagstones on at least one side. You can catch a glimpse of this original dirt road and the flagstones on the western side of the ramp, where we excavated below the ramp level. A marks the flagstones alongside the original road. C is the threshold of the propylon. Notice how the ramp of the propylon begins to rise from D to B.
In front of the easternmost tower, we discovered the remains of a small altar, surrounded by a great quantity of ash. The remains of this collapsed altar are labeled C. Those thin slabs of stones were probably arranged around a dirt altar, similar to this one which we excavated near Ulansey in 1994. Such altars at the entrances to cities are a commonplace all over the ancient Mediterranean world. In the early 4th century, the Bylazorans built their propylon. This entailed demolishing the two large towers and building two smaller, perhaps ceremonial, towers. The remnants of the western tower are incorporated into the Acropolis wall. Of the eastern tower, we are uncertain because it was completely quarried away later in the 2nd century BC. Two small ceremonial towers now flanked an inclined ramp built directly atop the earlier road. Looking from the north to the south, we have the Acropolis wall designated M11.2. Towards the bottom of the photograph, you see that the wall is thicker. That's because at this spot, the remains of the first tower were incorporated into the wall. N11.16 is the western ceremonial tower. L22.10 is the western wall of the propylon and part of the back wall. The eastern part of the propylon was quarried away down into its foundations in antiquity. We would unearth some of this wall in a later year. Finally, there is a threshold, M13.8, that separated the ramp of the propylon from the rectangular room.
To inaugurate the construction of the propylon, and to ensure the blessings of the gods for this project, the Bylazorans laid down a large terracotta surface atop the old road surface. On this surface, the Bylazorans sacrificed some small animals and burned their bodies along with some foodstuffs and grain. We found the remains of this terracotta altar and the charred bones directly beneath the stones of the ramp. The inclined ramp led up to a gated threshold, which in turn led to a small rectangular room whose paving stones were laid flat. Beyond the rectangular room was a large open area of hard-packed pebbles on the Acropolis. Thick walls flanked this propylon complex. From the evidence of previous year's excavations, we believe the propylon was roofed over. Another small altar was built in front of the eastern ceremonial tower, but on a slightly higher level. A great mass of ash and burnt bones was found scattered around this altar. This is how we reconstructed the propylon.
The most difficult aspect of the recreation of the Propylon concerns its gating system. We had initially assumed that any such structure would require a gate at its entrance between the two ceremonial towers, but the evidence is actually to the contrary. Between the ceremonial towers, there are no threshold blocks, no jam stones, no socket stones, no cuts in the ramp stones indicating any sort of gate or door mechanism. In addition, the hard-packed pebble road north of the ramp comes right up to the first extant stones of the ramp, proving there are no missing stones at the entrance to the Propylon. What we have, in short, is an open Propylon without an entrance gate. But there is an entrance gate within the Propylon. The paving stones of the ramp are laid on an incline. The ramp stones stop at a line of raised threshold blocks. Crossing over this threshold, one comes to a rectangular room whose paving stones are laid flat, not on an incline. Our problem becomes how to reconstruct the gating mechanism between the ramp and the rectangular room.
The threshold is made of four ashlars so closely placed side by side as to leave little space between them. All the stones of the threshold are cut at two different levels, the higher portion on the ramp side, the lower on the rectangular room side. This dual level runs across all four ashlars. In stone one, a square socket hole has been cut. Into the square socket hole, we believe that a wooden piece with a bowl-shaped hole for the foot pivot would have been inserted. For its part, the dual level of the stones on the inner part of the threshold created a natural door stop for the gate, which swung across the lower level, then bumped and closed against the higher level. Some uncertainties remain about the gate type, namely, whether it was a single door or a double door gate. At first glance, the double door gate solution is more usual and convenient. In fact, most of the time this was the manner in which the ancients closed their gateways, particularly in the case of a city gate. But there are problems with this reconstruction.
If it had been a double door, there would have been the usual block, pinhole, or bolt hole cut somewhere about midway along the threshold to stabilize the locked gate. There is no such hole in our threshold. But in stone four, there's a 4 centimeter wide, 2 centimeter deep round bolt hole 23 centimeters away from stone one. In other words, nowhere near the center, as it would be for a double door gate, but about as far away from the socket block as could be, as it would be for a single door gate. The reason for the building of the Propylon remains a mystery. There is the curious fact that in the foundations of the threshold of the inner Propylon gate, there are large, well-dressed stones that appear to have been cut for an earlier building. This is in stark contrast to the stones of the western wall of the Propylon, which are irregularly shaped and only very roughly dressed. In addition, a reused triglyph fragment was found in the foundations of the western ceremonial tower. This suggests that earlier and finer buildings were either destroyed or less likely dismantled, and their stones reused in the construction of the Propylon.
The Propylon was a short-lived structure. It was destroyed in the middle of the 4th century BC, probably by Philip II when he attacked the Paionians in 358 BC. Not only was the Propylon destroyed, but significant sections of the adjoining Acropolis defensive wall were destroyed as well. Soon squatters moved into the ruins of the Propylon, utilizing what walls still remained standing. They added a few wattle and daub and clay walls of their own to these ruins, as you see in this reconstruction. Here, highlighted in red, is one such wall. The ceramic evidence was first analyzed by Jo-Simon Stoka, who dated this first squatter period to circa 350 to 275 BC, which neatly correlates with the time span from Philip's invasion of 358 to the invasion of the Danubian Gauls in 279 BC. A preliminary typology of the ceramics was presented by Candace Richards in Volume 1 of the TFAHR Bylazora publication. In Volume 2, Elizabeth Demirny further analyzed this pottery.
After the destruction of the habitations of the first squatter period within the Propylon complex, squatters moved into the ruins once again. In preparation for doing so, this second group of squatters laid down an approximately 60 centimeter deep layer of fill soil, atop which they then built their flimsy structures. In this photograph, you can see a hearth from the first squatter period, labeled E, and one from the second squatter period, labeled F. These hearths are separated by about 60 centimeters of fill soil. In most places, this fill soil is fairly sterile, but occasionally an odd vessel or two turned up in the fill. Little remains of the second squatter period anywhere in Sector 3 because of its proximity to the topsoil, which was regularly worked by farmers until quite recently. The Paionians managed to regain their independence from Macedonia at some point after the Gallic invasion, but in 217 BC, the Macedonian king Philip V conquered Bylazora, as described by Polybius. Philip fortified and utilized the city as his northern defense against the warlike Dardanians, who were threatening Macedonia at this time. Philip V hastily repaired the northern Acropolis walls around the ruined Propylon. We found the remains of these last defensive walls. The excavation of this trench to the east of the Propylon was directed by Slavomir Šiška, who sorted out the various structures as follows. A marks the remains of the foundation of the original tower, which predated the Propylon. B, the remains of the original Acropolis wall. C is the first altar. D is a stone of the Propylon ramp. E marks the remains of the Propylon's altar. F is a fill layer. G marks the walls built by Philip V. H is a robber trench from the quarrying operations after the abandonment of Bylazora. And finally, I designates the corner of one of the terrace houses.
Bylazora was destroyed and abandoned in the 2nd century BC. Sometime after its abandonment, quarrying operations began. Large buildings like the Propylon and the Acropolis walls were systematically dismantled, and the largest stones were carried away. Smaller stones were piled up and burned down to make lime mortar. Only systematic quarrying would account for the fact that we found no large stones strewn about the site, as one would normally expect in a city that met a violent end. What we discovered, rather, were robber trenches crisscrossing the site. It seems that the quarrymen quarried away not only the stones of the walls of the buildings, but they worked down into the foundations of the walls as well, stopping only when it became too difficult to pry out and lift these lower stones. The Propylon was quarried away right down to its foundations. No traces of the eastern ceremonial tower survive, but only a scar in the ramp remains where it once stood. Likewise, little remains of the eastern wall of the Propylon. Along the ramp, there are no stones at all, and in the rectangular room, just the foundations of the wall remain. One course remains of the western wall, and two courses of the western ceremonial tower.
To date, our research has not yielded any contemporary parallels to the Bylazora Propylon in other parts of the Balkans. Perhaps we are looking at a native Paionian architectural form.